Glory, 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 glory. You may be seated, please. I wanna read something from Psalm 23. You know, sometimes when we think of Psalm 23, we don't even need to turn to our Bibles. Because, you know, the world we know it, something like that. So we say. Alright, Psalm 23, and I'm going to read from verse 5, leave the rest. I still not going to borrow your Bible. Psalm 23, verse 5 and 6. There are some nuggets that I have to drop so that the Lord can save a few. Thou, the Lord. This is the servant of the Lord speaking to the Lord. This is a kingdom citizen, King of heaven, talking to the Lord. This is someone who is constant to the fact that it is the kingdom of God that sustains. Amen. Now, if you're taking notes, I want you to draw a little diagram. I want you to draw a little diagram in your notes. On the left side, you have, far left, you have the blood of Jesus Christ. Then you have equal, the sign equal. Blood of Jesus Christ equals the blood of the everlasting covenant, center spread. That's what is center spread. The blood of the everlasting covenant. So what you'll see when you put it down there is the blood of Jesus Christ equals the blood of the everlasting covenant. Hallelujah. Then at the far right now, you write the kingdom of God. All right, having that diagram, that picture in your mind, let's see if we can drop some nuggets. When we say thou, it's coming from the recipient of the blood of Jesus Christ bringing salvation, the blood of the everlasting covenant. That when we first heard the utterance, we didn't know what people were talking about when they said that to us. But then the blood of the everlasting covenant steps into the kingdom of God. And that is the governing influence. I leave out a word. The sustaining governing influence. The sustaining governing influence of the citizenship of heaven. The sustaining governing influence of the citizenship of heaven by the Lord God. That is the kingdom of God. And when we are able to put it in perspective, when we are able to put the last part, the kingdom of God, in perspective, we realize that when you are asked to give your heart to Jesus Christ, when you get saved by applying to the washing of the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, In intelligent people say that don't make sense. Because the blood of Jesus Christ, if we're going to describe it as the blood that flowed out of his body on the Palestinian earth, how much can that do to say save man's sin? If you're going to reason it out, look at it and reason it out. It don't make sense. If an ignorant person said the Bible don't make sense, I might be tempted to agree. God isn't, we didn't come to make sense. Didn't come to make sense. Eh? But then when you're there reasoning out the blood, that you know what blood is supposed to be. Huh? If you don't know, we always have an anti-hercule in the house. So we have a doctor now to ask. So we can say, you know, tell us what blood is really. And we have Erica's sister over here. So what's your name again? The one that me always borrow Bible from. What's your name again? Alisa, she didn't know. Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. Wonderful family we have. Then you realize now, sir, that statement, no, that part of it can't make sense. And then when you are able to step up into a new realm and you say, the blood of the everlasting covenant. Now, what that means? Sorry, I have to laugh sometimes. I find that when people say things are deep, it's because they don't understand. Yeah, that's like, oh, that is so awesome. The word was rich. Then don't understand. And the speaker sometimes speaking over the head. And so, you know. So the blood of the everlasting covenant, you speak that with authority. And people say, oh, he's awesome. But what does that mean? Still don't know. But it is one of my most awesome revelation that God has given me that day. Because since I was I was trying to remember what Papa San said, but it got for me. Since me little bit and I grow, little teeny and I grow, right? I've been wondering, what is the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God? And you know when, because you got it. You got it when it dropped on me, you got it too, right? And to see that the kingdom of heaven is a country. Eh? It's a kingdom. And the sustenance of that kingdom is the influence of the king himself. Amen? When it hit me, I had to go right back to the blood of Jesus Christ. And when I was going through the blood of the everlasting covenant, mean the same thing, the transformation was sweeter when the blood of Jesus Christ equaled the blood of the everlasting covenant appeared to me to be the kingdom of God. So when we say thou, this is somebody like me standing in this position, or whoever of us standing in this position, being recipient of such knowledge and revelation. In other words, it's not a wonderment. It is a place of confidence that, yes, I've been touched by, not an angel, I've been touched by the influence of the Lord God himself. So I'm standing here as a foolproof witness that when we say thou and whatever else we are going to say, the person that we are addressing deserves what we are going to say about. So it's not just any other. It's not a little waiter who don't even get no training. It's not one of those bossy restaurant managers who stand up and, you know, just tell some people what to do and they don't know themselves what to do. It's not that. Our servant. Oh my God, this is moving me away too. This is touching my heart in a deep way. Our servant is the top guy in the house. Our server is the top guy in the house. This is one of the nuggets that the Lord asked me to just bear so he can save some. He's asking, the Lord God is asking for a servant's heart. And that servant is with attributes communicated to us by him himself, the Lord God himself. And this is the word of the Lord, that it's going nowhere when you sit there with a little foolishness on your mind, or stand there with a little foolishness on your mind and think that you have knowledge. That was not even processed information. The Lord is saying, learn of me. Come and learn of me. Come see, go tell. Come and learn of me. So when you are privileged to serve my people, you look like me. When you are privileged to communicate anything to my people in any way, whether it is to preach, to sing, to feed them with physical food or whatever, you look like me, said the Lord. And the Lord is saying, you can't represent me if you don't look like me. Hallelujah. You can't represent me if you don't look like me. There's a point where sometimes we have four people to do the work. The Lord God put four people to get the job done. Put the verse 5 up here for me. It's up there. The Lord has four people to get the job done. And because of the attitude of one or two, less people are left to do the four people work. Because it is easier to adopt a cankerworm approach than to employ a selfless approach. Selflessness sometimes look like you lose. Selflessness look like you're not going to make it. You don't have enough. That's why people thief the tithes. Because they don't understand the investment. Laugh, because you must say, but it's my money. Where you get it from? It's my time. Where you get it from? It's my breath. Where you get it from? I had a little conversation with somebody some time ago. And I said, well, he's saying what I'm talking is foolishness. There's no God. There's no hell. There's no heaven. There's no this, that. And I said, all right, let's do an Elijah here. In the next 3 minutes, your breath is going to stop. If you agree. If we agree in the exercise we're going to do, you have to put your life on the line. If there is a God, you're going to agree with me that in the next 3 minutes, you're not going to have any breath to breathe, because I'm telling you, God gave you that. Do you agree? So no, I can't agree, something I don't understand. I said, well, welcome to the club. You don't understand a simple thing. That's a simple thing. If you can't run with the foot soldiers, how you going to manage when the chariots and the horses start march? So the conversation never go further than that. That he didn't want to come into something. We are not sure if after 3 minutes he will have any breath to breathe. Where did the breath come from? Can you explain that? Where did the breath come from? I said, I can do it. I can tell you that in 3 minutes' time, I'll still be breathing. How you know that? Well, come now, make it. You don't want to try. Make it to our work party and see who's standing up or down. Never want that. He's a wise man. A wise man. But the emphasis the Lord wants to make is when you say, thou, and then you're giving him some kudos, you should be accurate. Can you be accurate when it comes to the Lord God? You see, ladies and gentlemen, I've had ringside seat with this match of playing church. And I have done some of it myself. Playing church. And everybody is, you know, awesome and righteous, and everybody a Christian. And the relationship is not so strong. But we are saved here and put here to represent. Now, the representation, and this is another nugget that, please don't make it miss you. The representation, it's not to get rid of the other three people. Remember the four? It's not to get rid of, work hard to get rid of the other three people, or to put them down so that you can look good. Looking good, don't cut it. Looking good, don't cut it. Being able to finish, to manage and finish the task at hand is all that you get paid for. You would want to be at your best self when you are doing that task. It is already penciled. That's a four-man job. Don't kill the other three. It will be harder for you. But religious circles don't know how to work with that. They come to kill. They come to shoot. Everything that looks like it is not according to their way of thinking, they are ready to shoot. And I think these nuggets the Lord dropping is to say, you don't shoot. I have a little friend in the movie circles. His name is Mr. Miyagi. How many people know Mr. Miyagi? Mr. Miyagi said, no, we don't fight. No, don't fight. Don't fight. Fighting is not good. Somebody always get hurt when you fight. Don't fight. And sometimes it look like it is because Mr. Miyagi can't fight. And then when them test him, them realize it. And then when he's walking away, him say, I told you. I told you don't fight. Somebody always get hurt when you fight. The Lord is saying, stop the fighting. And I'm sure you recognize that it is God is part two. All right? No fighting. What the song say, Rich? Stop your fighting. So early in the morning, yes, Mr. Brown, thank you very much. It's time to work. The Lord is saying to us that the people in the space that you are operating in are your helpers. These are the people that he has placed there to help you to get the job done that you are tasked to get done. Some of them, you might not even like them, or you might not even appreciate them, but those are the other part of the four people, the other three. People say, me, helper? I'm not a helper, I'm a doctor. I won't like to be a helper. Well, when the doctor, and Keisha, I'm not after you. When the doctor has the mentality that I must be the first responder, top helper, 95% of the job is done. When we have some little upstarts and wannabes who wants to be recognized as the top one, even though they haven't served the time and paid no dues, we have problems. It is you see it in all areas. And I tell you something, the voting populace are confused. The parties don't know who to put up, and they're juggling from one thief to another. I don't know what to put there. So that's why, that's where the church makes a difference. Kick Christianity to the curb. It's a debilitating experience. Kick religion out of the park completely. Because what those things are encouraging us to do is to try our best. You know, some of them girls say, try your best. That's what they're trying to do. Encouraging us to try our best. So the nicest people you meet and talk to, they're trying their best. The Lord said, I didn't call you to try your best. Try your best is not good enough. It's never going to be good enough. And we have it in school. Only your best is good enough. All right? We see where you're going and we see the good intention. But that wrong. Not even the best is good enough. What's good enough? Recognize thou. Recognize the thou. Recognize the Lord God. The kingdom of God that is there to sustain you. Apply it to the blood of Jesus Christ. And as you touch one, you touch all. That equation I give you. As you touch one, you touch all. So when the psalmist stands there, kneels there, sits there, whatever his posture is, and he says, thou preparest before me. He's not wondering, begging, or supposing, or wishing. He's not at the wishing well. He's speaking from a position of authority and confidence. Now, I grew up in circumstances seeing that too many people are pushing for and killing off people in the pursuit of power. Sometimes it goes through money. To get to the power. And I've seen many people with the power, with the money, with the power, and lose, can't manage the task because they have no, what's the word? Authority. They have no authority. Now sometimes you don't even know where the power is. But because you have the authority from the power source, the boss just touch your shoulder and say, go open that gate. You have the authority to open it. When you open the gate, oh my God, blessings flood. Because you have the authority. Say, can you have the power? You say, but can you have the authority of the power? Of course. Power is not really mine. The omnipotence is not really mine. It just passed through me. To God is doing. But authority is what we're after. When this man said, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. No fear is there. No enemy make up fears. It can cause no fear because he is in position of authority. He feels the power driving every inch of his body. So it is not just a little prayer that everybody know, a psalm that everybody, thou preparest table before me in the presence of mine enemies, and we don't know what that is. There are so many nuggets in one little area. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. I want to tell you the other part before I come back to the last part of that. Thou anointest my head with oil. No, he's not telling you to start a religion of anointing head with coconut oil. That's not what he's saying. He's saying, you hear one scripture say, he beautifies the meek with his salvation. He means that. You are at feast. Come back to the prepare the table. You are at feast. Not when the enemy is not there. But when I say so, said the Lord. You're at feast. And you don't look like a pauper at feast. You're not picking up crumbs because the enemy is, and Gideon is hiding behind the wine press. He said, the angel said, come here, mighty man of valor. Oh, me? Me? You couldn't be talking to me. Yes, you. If does it need a testimony to reassure you that God can for you to come and say, I did so and so, you know, and that happened, and whatever. No. Don't need another testimony. While you are having a feast, the table prepared, while you are having the feast, you are having a countenance, a pleasantness. Can't talk to you no, because you don't know what just happened. Me and auntie just drop out, and my father broke his foot. And is this the child of God we're talking about? Yeah. Is this the child of God? And you can't do nothing because some grief attend your part. Is that are you being a good witness? Is that what you're supposed to be? Well, I wish I had the whole day to give you these nuggets, but you know me, when I present, there's always a part that you have to fly out to. Eh? So let me move on to something else. Lord Jesus Christ did say in St. John chapter 14, write this down. St. John 14, verse 2 to 6. Put it up there for me. St. John 14, verse 2 to 6. This is a seriously awesome piece of literature. St. John, tell me when it's there. St. John 14, verse 2 to 6. All right. Could you look at it, Wally Mike and Jackie, and read it for me?
In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way, ye know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
And verse 6 of Psalm 23 say what? Just quote it. You can just quote it. Surely. It's no guesswork. No guesswork. Where did he get it from? We just read it a while ago. Thomas said, hold on, let me go to Thomas. Thomas said, Lord, you lick your head something, you want to sleep? We don't know where you're going. We have never been there. We don't know. Jesus said, you don't have to go anywhere. I'm here. In my Father's house are many mansions. Now, this is not how our English shows it go. The mansion is the bigger. Eh? The house is the smaller. Eh? Well, there is an awesome piece of revelation right in there, sir. You know? You remember I told you the other day, I was standing here when the revelation hit me and I said that God was investing himself in the eternal sonship. That is what is called seventh day. Eh? You don't need to go back to jurisprudence and check to see, because you can't get it right. Can I tell you that you cannot get it right? Can I tell you that many people say that the Bible is confusing because they cannot manage to relate to, they can't wrap the brain around how Jesus was crucified on Friday and so 3 days and then get up Sunday morning early. You can't wrap it around. You don't need to wrap it around. Jesus was not crucified on Friday. Somebody call it Good Friday. Well, then can go and call it. Jesus crucified, we up on Wednesday. When was the feast? Thursday night. How do you know? Because it is in jurisprudence. Just lazy people don't want to go look at the people and thing and study it. So that's just a offshoot. We get my glory here. So Jesus said, in my father's house, him owned this. In my father's house right here are all the expansiveness of your anticipation that every kingdom citizen desire to come into in all its fullness. It's your mansion. It's your mansion. It cannot be so. All of what Jesus said can't be just explained by the wizzy. Whatever is your anticipation, whatever is your desire, all the riches of your desire. My father have a house that can entertain Sean Owen and Samantha Owen and Rudy Owen. God have one house. Now, when he set himself to tabernacle himself in the ice, and call himself there, so Jesus, the Christ, the Son of the Living God. You see, jurisprudence had a little whiff of something. When you say, that's why they were after him sometime, trying to kill him before time. Because when he says, the Son of God, when he say, he's the Son of God, when he say, Patrick is the son of his father, you are saying that whatever Patrick's father is, that's him. And the people were saying, who dare you to put yourself in that position? You are the Son of God? You mean our God that Moses started about? The God that wrote thunder and destroyed people and all be out? That's who you say you are? Yes. And I'm not just saying that. I'm saying, I am the truth too. Who is saying that? But I'm not just saying that. I am the life too that is saying that. And all of that is wrapped up in my Father's house. And my Father's house is present here in his eternal sonship. Come into my Father's house. And you don't have to count the days, which one. I told you already now. If a government come in and say Wednesday, you know, move me. Huh? They say, let's work all the other days and go to church. Everybody go to church on Wednesday. Then you go and have civil war, you know, because you know how people are. They fight for everything. You understand? But guess what? I'll just pick up my Bible and come to BLT on Wednesday. Hallelujah. Why? Because I'm not worshiping the day. The day that man culture upon God. Because I tell you this, I can't go into it all. You know, but what we have is Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. A man fix up that. You know, hallelujah, please help me, Jesus. This I can't just give you a little synopsis of. You see, when you say, on the first day, second day, the third day, down to the sixth day, it's not days like how you know it. Child of God, kingdom citizen, lift your gaze. It could never be that. You know, when people like to show off, like them know something about when they say, in this season, it's my season, and whatever. It's a little whiff of something, but they don't understand. But the first day, the essence of that was the first season that God purposed to reveal this. It's not that God no have no workshop. That him going to go make some trees and make some and make two man and that's how God did. It is his season that he purposed to reveal of himself in this wise. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, to the birth of Jesus Christ. Was on this wise. And then when he's finished now, when he reached the sea, all put together different seasons and said, man, you are good now. This is you. He actually said, you are very good. You read it, it's there in Genesis. You are very good. And then man in man's very good state would have been the best that man could have desired. Praise Jesus. Remember I told you, it's a very emotional time for me, but I come into it. It's the best that man could have desired. Man didn't know anything about the seventh day. Didn't have a clue as to how to desire anything like seventh day. When God gave man his full desire, then the scripture said, when the scripture said God rested, God don't need to sleep. God don't get tired. So he needs a little cessation, a little sleep, a little fooling of the hands to sleep. So what he did now is that he, you know, you say put on the brata. He made the provisions he made was that man, his premier creation, would never be wiped out. Could never be wiped out, regardless of what man do with what him give him. Call 6 days of work. He invested of himself in a man look like us. And said, this is your, if I say it this way, probably it will drive, you know, an easy understanding. This is your security. But he has to accurately say, this is your rest. So all ye that labor, everybody who pressed through all your desire and pushed through and did everything that they think they was the ultimate they could do, and all of that just come to superfluity of nothingness in the sixth day. Him say, this is your rest. Not his rest. Our rest. God don't need no rest. God is rest. Hallelujah. I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, understanding is not just to talk about it. We don't know what we're doing. And the best thing we can do, and don't be upset when me tell you, say, you don't know what you're doing, because I don't know what I'm doing either. We are, the best we can do is avail ourselves and watch the space. The revelation flow and pick us up like an eagle, salvaging us from the deep. And this is our rest. In my Father's house, in my Father's rest, are many mansions, all you can desire. All the righteous, all the awesome, all the good that you can desire. Your mansion. It's in individually. It's in my Father's house. All right? Okay. While we go through this earthly house in this tabernacle, give me one more scripture. Genesis 49, verse 22. So the question is, what's next? What do we do? How do we change this vile body? What is it? You remember Alice Taylor said, enough of the murderers as heroes. Never mind all they accomplished, think them accomplished. That's why we have the country still like us today. Give us Shelley Ann. Give us Miss Lou as national heroes. Why? Because Miss Lou go and say, Auntie Roshi say, Miss Lou is going to give you some joke and Shelley is going to run for us. And somebody is going to be able to look and say, I want to be like that woman. We have some scholars, but the reason why I don't call them is because they are not so well known. They're not so well known to us. But internationally, we have some creme de la creme scholars from the archives of academia. When they drop out over somewhere, when they touch base somewhere, people marvel. See now, weep and mourn. Because we're bright down here. So. Oh, yeah. So let's keep it at people who the populace know. Miss Lou, Shelley Ann, national heroes, heroines of the people. That's what we're calling for. We register it from Worship Center. That we want Shelley Ann Fraser Price and Louise Coverley to be national heroes as ASAP. Tell them, Cher. Tell them for me, yeah? Pull one string there, Cher. I'll make something jump out. Hallelujah. All right. Who's going to read this one for me now? You have it up there? Go for it, Stu. You can see it? Genesis 49, verse 32. 22, sorry, 22. Did I say 32? I misspoke. 22.
Joseph is a fruitful bough, even fruitful bough by a well, whose branches run over the wall.
All right, Stu, you can sit down. Mr. Say, you know, sit down. Yeah. Something hit you, don't you? Hey, what do we do? How do we get the job done? How can we be the kind of witnesses that God requires of us? This desire. Set your heart on Joseph's. This was Jacob pronouncing blessings upon his son. Huh? Awesome man of God. And this is what him pronounced upon Joseph. Oh my God. I say, look here. Imagine what kind of tree we have that we could relate to that. A mango tree. Eh? You just imagine some trees that you know. Them they're inside. You know something that happened to me sometime? The neighbor tree in the neighbor yard. But the bearing part over my yard. Oh, Jesus. Sometimes we feel like we have to pick some and give to the neighbor. Hey, listen. I have something to tell you. Don't you? You have to sit down good for here. These are nuggets. You see? All right. Before I get to the bowl, I want to tell you something else. You see the cup that is upturned? Some people don't even have a cup. Some people cup no upturn. Them balling for every striking thing, and you don't do that. The child of God don't ball for every striking thing. You anticipate it. Why? Because it's in the man's head, that's how it go. It is the way we go. Okay? All right. So your cup upturned. And the blessings that is apportioned you, full up your cup. and it run over into your saucer. I heard somebody singing a stupid song once and saying, I'm drinking from my saucer. I would like him to repent and change that song. What is in the saucer is not yours. If it's your cup, don't drink from your saucer. I'm a virgin fully. Thanks to God. Grieving but rejoicing anyway. That's true. What is in the saucer is for the neighbors, the strangers, the people who see you and like you and say, I like what you have. Can I have some? Huh? Yeah. Don't drink from your saucer. It's not yours. It is the blessing that show you off. It's not we show off, you know. It's God show us off. By the torrents of overflow we have going over our cup edge. Woohoo! The rivers of blessings flowing over our cup edge. That's what shows off. Stop the fleshy foolishness and calling it church. It might be Christianity. Some nickname something from around so. But it is not kingdom life. Not kingdom life. When one meet a brother or a sister, even if they don't have it all together, but you sense that there's, you sense something. Yeah, your heart burning and say, boy, you know, what a wonderful person this is, you know. What a sweet girl she is, you know. What a nice man, you understand? Because God's showing you off. God's showing you off. So, when you desire that kind of a Joseph blessing, your fruitfulness can't stay in your mansion. Let's call it that. Your fruitfulness, your mansion don't have enough space to hold your fruitfulness. So it have to go over the wall. Then one other thing with over the wall, you have no control over who will benefit. Oh, clap your hand and make noise. Make some noise. Hallelujah. You have no control over what happened over the wall. And some people think a thief, them a thief from you, you know. And you stand up on your house top and look upon them and say, you step on your balcony and look upon them and you say, you know, you go ahead, man. Fill your bag. Enjoy yourself. Blessed be the name of Jesus. It is the Lord. It is my God. And my mansion is expressed. This is Father's house, brother. My mansion is expressed. Now, I saw Regina's heart when she said, if I could, I would. It's her heart. It is a touching situation. And many of us, as parents and guardians and so on, we've come to some times like these when we wish that we could. You know, a doctor said to me the other day, she was talking to a group of us, she said, don't worry, but when you reach 19, 20, you don't really have it together. It's 25 before the whole thing connect, you see? So you have a little time, son. Don't make the decision too far. So 25 is when the things start happening. And then she was talking nice until this point. And then she said, but for the men, it's a little later. And I said, we were almost friends, and then you go and talk the wrong thing. Hey, hallelujah. Oh, glory, glory, glory. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. I can imagine that many people will have the kind of a heart and approach, and sometimes they mix it up with, they think that it, that is relationship with the Lord. But what Regina had was just a nice humanitarian concern. You hear? Because she didn't have the answer. She said, not trashing her work, but she said, if I could, I would. That's a good heart. That's all. If I could, I would. And it has happened to us. It's happened to us. Some of us who are listening to me now, it's happened to us that we wish we could. We wish we could. I imagine somebody said in the aftermath, said, if I could prevent destiny from dying, I would. But you, and there are other people. Now when you look at Mama T, who was 99, you don't say, nobody said that. Don't say that. Mama T, as Erica said, Mama T tired. She go on home, go rest. She 99. Huh? But you know when they are younger, you know, and even though they might have been sick, even though Michelle's mother was not so well, you know, just to see that she gone now and, you know, Mama is passed, it can rub you the wrong way, not you? You could be the best, the nicest grief manager. It shake your foot a little bit. The only thing I encourage my people to do is don't shake out. Be firm and be real, and it will come around. And if you come talk to me, we'll talk together and make it work. You understand? I'm a hardened grief manager. I've been there so many times. I have the experience. I am preaching here, and my father is there, so and my brother is there, so in the boxes. Eh? And I am going crying here, so I'm going back. I'm crying, I'm done. My time again, I come out back and deal with the thing. Eh? I was well trained, don't you? Well equipped for this thing. Amen? But the best that we can do in all that we have up to the sixth day is something like what you hear Regina singing, if I could, I would. If I could, I would, but we can't. We can't. I can't. In other words, I can't cry your tears for you. Listen? And it's time, brother, sister, ladies and gentlemen, it's time that we really learn the thing for ourselves and teach it to our children. That there needs to be a relationship with the rest. The eternal sonship of God. That is what Joseph was saying. That's what Jacob was saying to his son Joseph. I pronounce the rest upon you. I pronounce the rest upon you. It is with all of my heart. I'd love to be able. It feels a way when I see that you failed the exam and I couldn't do it for you. When I see that you try your best and you never get picked on the team. When I see that it rough going for you and you don't even understand. And with all of your, you know, scholastic attainment and you think, say, boy, you bright and you have it together, you come to a point where you can't go no further. But that's why we are here as the church. Not to play Christianity. Not to romp with religion. But to get connected. To get connected so that we can be rich. Our blessings can be so rich. We can be enriched that we don't even have to pay attention to what is hanging over the wall. There are many people that would really do well when they are thirsty, frustrated, tired, and walking along that pathway. And when your orange tree, when your orange is hanging over low down, that they can pick. You know what I see some people do? Chop off the limb. Chop off the limb that would bear over there. Because they're selfish. They don't understand. Don't understand. That's not yours. That is for the passerby. Now, this is not saying that you should be stupid stewards. Because, what did I hear somebody say recently? That the takers, you have to have a limit when you give. Because the takers don't have none. I'm sorry, I have to throw in a caution there on the bottom. So, have a limit when you give because the takers don't have none. Right? My heart is, you see me here trying to close this message. My heart goes out to the people who should win, so we think, who could win, so it look, but didn't because they chose the wrong road. They chose to try to wheeze it out than to desire it out. I think I've found an ace that I could keep. This one. Can close on this one. I'm encouraging you to choose the desire road and reject the wheezy road. You know, you think you have something? You go with that. As soon as that win, you lose. But if you desire an expanse and you call it your mantra, Jesus, I can fit it in my house. Those who can stand with you, please change your posture, please. Stand up with me.